On this first day of October, international military tensions, headline CNN 10. I'm your host, Carl Azus. It's always good to have you watching. We've reported before on the controversy concerning artificial Chinese islands in the South China Sea. Today, we're exploring international tensions with Russia on the other side of the Northern Hemisphere, in the Black Sea. This Eastern European body of water is strategically important because it connects through the Mediterranean to the Atlantic Ocean. It's surrounded by Ukraine, Russia, Georgia, Turkey, Romania, and Bulgaria. Those three last countries are members of NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. That makes them allies of the United States, another NATO member. The organization was created in 1949 to protect Western European nations against the Soviet Union, and in recent years, as Russia has made moves to assert its power in the Black Sea region, NATO members have been making moves of their own to assert the strength of their military alliance. There have been questions about that strength in recent years. NATO countries are supposed to spend 2% of their gross domestic product on their militaries. But while America has done that, most other NATO countries haven't. U.S. President Donald Trump has repeatedly criticized NATO members for not spending enough on the alliance, so critics have questioned if the U.S. is still committed to NATO. The leader of the U.S. European Command says America's security commitments to NATO are, quote, ironclad. As a demonstration of that, American planes and ships have been conducting military exercises in the area around the Black Sea, and they've been harassed by Russian planes in the process.
The U.S. Navy on the move deep into what Russia considers its backyard. We're on board a P-8 maritime warfare and surveillance plane in the Black Sea. It's a heavily militarized region, and we're told Russian jets are in the air. The crew spots one creeping up. It's an Su-27 fighter jet. It seems to be moving out of reach. But suddenly, our plane is buzzed. The encounter, fast. We catch the fighter just as it's pulling away.
Could be an unpredictable pilot, maybe a new pilot or something like that. So that can always be a challenge. We do keep on constant alert when we're being intercepted.
The crew is tracking several other Russian jets nearby.
Encounters like this one with Russian warplanes are not uncommon for U.S. military personnel flying in places like the Black Sea. In fact, the U.S. military says they're becoming more common, and also some of them are conducted in an unsafe manner.
In late August, two Russian interceptors nearly rammed a B-52 operating here in what the U.S. says was an unsafe intercept. Russia says it was operating according to international norms, but there's no doubt Moscow is growing more brazen. The P-8 flying straight into the lion's den, right off Russia's main Black Sea naval port, Sevastopol, on the Crimean Peninsula. The crew tracked 10 Russian military vessels nearby, including this Kilo-class submarine, before checking on a U.S. destroyer, the Roosevelt, which was also being shadowed by a Russian warship.
Really, it's a message to all potential adversaries a message to our allies and partners that we're here to support them, keep the freedom and prosperity open for the entire continent of Europe.
And that includes missions into difficult and contested areas like the Black Sea, where Russia continues to try and grow its influence. Fred Pletkin, CNN in the Black Sea.
It was at times a contentious and chaotic first presidential debate.
Well, you want to rebuild every building.
My plan.
You want to rebuild
right.
Every building.
And the Commission on Presidential Debates says it may change the structure of the remaining presidential face-offs to make sure they're more orderly. Tuesday night's debate was not the most watched in history. Nielsen Media Research says across four major American media networks, there was a 36% decrease in viewership from the record set in 2016. But the current candidates kept after each other, hitting the campaign trail on Wednesday. Incumbent Republican President Donald Trump was set to travel to Minnesota, while Democratic presidential nominee Joe Biden planned to visit Pennsylvania and Ohio. The candidates have had to make changes to how they campaign in this era of coronavirus, and CNN 10 contributor Kelly Mena reports on changes made on debate night. Kelly.
Thanks, Carl. Now let's take a look at how the pandemic is changing the presidential debates this year. Like every aspect of American society, the debates have had to adapt to life amid the health threat of COVID-19. To start, Tuesday was the first of three presidential debates headed into November. Unlike 4 years ago, the candidates did not shake hands, a time-honored tradition of good sportsmanship. President Donald Trump and Joe Biden also did not shake hands with moderator Chris Wallace. the candidates, who usually stand close to each other on stage, were socially distanced at their respective podiums. Unlike previous years, where debate venues were packed with audience members that cheered and applauded for their candidate, this year's verbal standoff featured much less audience participation. Less than 100 audience members were present at the live event. All those who were in attendance were tested for COVID-19 and followed strict health safety guidelines. Carl, while the coronavirus is changing certain aspects of the debates, one thing remains certain. It's must-watch TV and could go a long way in determining the outcome of the presidential general election.
10-second trivia. Dynamic apnea, variable weight, and free immersion are categories of what activity? Triathlon, free diving, sleeping, or fishing? The answer here is free diving, an extreme sport whose competitors hold their breath. It's very dangerous. Even a record-holding freediver says at the bottom of a dive, what you experience can feel like a dream or a nightmare, and you still have to find your way back to the surface. Lung damage, passing out, and drowning are an ever-present threat to people who do this, yet with a deep breath, they're continually drawn to the deep.
When you reach one world record, it's like a dream. But when you reach two world records, it's like a start of the career. It's not one time I reach a world record because it's a good moment. It's more important now for me because I have just 24 years old. A big connection with the sea. It's really like a romantic connection, I think, because I discovered freediving at 7 with my dad in Marseille in France, and at 16 I have a lot of difficulty in school. I'm dyslexic, and this part of my life is so difficult because in the past I'm really shy with the people. When I try freediving for the first time, I go in the depths and I open my eyes and I just see the blue. And no fish, no rocks, just the blue one. In this part of my dive, I see a mirror and I feel what I need to do for the next of my life. For go at these depths, you need to be really confident in you. You need to be really comfortable with what you do in the bottom, because you can't stop in the bottom. You are at 100 and more meters. You can say, okay, now I'm tired, I can stop. It's not like that. It's a really extreme sport. I'm really focused on the sensation. 1 minute on my dive, for me, is like one day. When I free fall in, because my lung is squeezed at 20 meters, I stop to swim. Just I free fall. It's like when you fly like a bird.
From the depths to the heights, British rescuers have just tested out a new jet suit for paramedics, and suddenly everyone wants to be a first responder. The advantage of this is that it saves time. A 25-minute walk over a mountainous landscape can now be done in a 90-second flight. Plus, people could get rescued by Iron Man. The disadvantage is that the suit can only fly for 5 or 10 minutes and can cost almost $500,000. And that could leave budgets in a turbine. But paramedics are known to act fast. These guys are flying. Paramedics are known to have nerves of steel. These guys have suits of iron. They always rise to the occasion and catch air in the job, so why wouldn't the new suit suit them? I'm Carl Azuz for CNN 10. We elected to go with the Senators today. That's the mascot of Sparkman High School in Harvest, Alabama. Thank you for your vote for CNN 10 at youtube.com/CNN.